Welcome, Peter, to the program.
Good morning, Lloyd, and thanks for having me.
All right. Now, let's get straight to the matter now. As I was saying before, there might very well be some people gathered in front of the University of the West Indies right now, and they are saying that by the university having removed Dr. Bain as head of chart, this has silenced Dr. Bain's freedom of speech, and it's a threat to academic freedom at the University of the West Indies. What say you?
Yeah, well, this is an important concern, you know, whether this is an infringement of academic freedom. But it is important to point out that Professor Bain has retired from the university as an academic. He's no longer employed as an academic. Following his retirement, he was given a two-year contract as director of chart, a position that he held previously while he was an academic, but he is no longer an academic. And the vice chancellor made it clear that if he were still an academic employed by UWI, and he was director of chart, even if that directorship was removed, there would have been no change in his academic standing.
Mm-hmm.
The project would have been removed and he would have continued his academic work. But because he's no longer employed as an academic, it means he was only employed for this specific project.
So in other words, if Dr. Bain had, let us say he was teaching a class, and he said, well, it is my belief that the Bugger Law should be maintained because of reason X, Y, and Z. He would not have been silenced. He would not have been penalized. He would not have been punished for having made that statement.
Absolutely not, because there are individuals up at the university who are saying that on a regular basis. That's not the issue.
And the issue is because there was a conflict of interest between being head of chart and the position which he held and expressed in this litigation suit in the Belize. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that is correct. You see, once he appeared on the side of the churches in this litigation, the churches are in support of retaining this law that dates back to 1851, which criminalizes persons on the basis of their sexual orientation. And once Brendan appeared on their behalf, even though he appeared as an expert witness, then the assumption is that he supports retaining the law.
Mm-hmm.
So in his testimony, he did not address, he would have had to say explicitly that he was not in favor of retaining the law if one were to draw that conclusion. The only conclusion you can draw based on his testimony is that he is in support of retaining the law. What is more, is that Brendan has been, for years, a representative of UWI and chart on the Pan-Caribbean Partnership Against AIDS. Now, the Pan-Caribbean Partnership Against AIDS brings together the CARICOM governments, members of civil society, and members of the international and bilateral organizations and the donors. And the PANCAP has explicitly stated that our collective Caribbean experience shows that we have got to repeal these laws. This is written in the last Caribbean Regional Strategic Framework, and it is an explicit goal to remove these laws in the 11 countries in the Caribbean that still has them.
Okay, so it is not likely that Dr. Bain would have testified, provided expert testimony in this case in Belize, not knowing that the body or the group that he was providing the testimony for was for the retaining of the Bogri law.
No, he would have been clear on that.
He would have been clear.
And he was also clear on the fact that there was an explicit position by the Caribbean Partnership Against AIDS, and the head of government, Dr. Denzil Douglas, who is Prime Minister of St. Kitts and Nevis, he is the head of government who has a responsibility for HIV and health in CARICOM, has explicitly supported the thrust of PANCAP.
Mm-hmm.
He has spoken on this, and the Gleaner editorial yesterday actually quoted his position on this. Now, within PANCAP, Brendan has never expressed any disagreement with this goal.
Mm-hmm.
So when he did go and give testimony, there was a lot of concern, not only within the vulnerable communities and among men who have sex with men, but there was a lot of dismay, concern, and shock within the Pan-Caribbean Partnership Against AIDS.
Well, Peter, Dr. Figueroa, are you surprised, really? Because it seemed to me that Dr. Bain, and he has chosen to be silent and allowing others to speak on his behalf or be critical, that he must have been a very conflicted individual, because it is not a secret that he is part of a religious movement that is for the retaining of the Bogri law. And for him, obviously, to be part of that religious movement and to be head of CHART, knowing fully well that, privately, let us say, the organization to which he belongs is a religious movement, is for the retain of the Bogri law, must have created a personal conflict for him. Address that for us.
Yes, I think you're absolutely correct, and we need to recognize this and appreciate it, because he is not the only one. There are many Christians who are conflicted on this point, because their beliefs, their moral outlook, believes that, men having sex with men is morally wrong. And I've been in the HIV work for many years, and most of my staff are devout Christians, and they have had to come to grips with this conflict. And many of us were aware that Brendan, he's a deep believer, and he does pastoral work, and we know that he, internally, he must have been conflicted. But the point is that within the PANCAP forums, he never really expressed any disagreement with this goal. And there are many Christians who, the more they reflect on it and the more that they experience what is involved in trying to prevent the epidemic, in interacting with persons who themselves are gay, they have come round to the view that the law is not helping us.
Mm-hmm.
And you can retain your personal views. You can still feel that it is morally wrong, but you recognize that the law is a significant barrier driving the epidemic underground. So most of us would have hoped, because we know of other pastors
mm-hmm.
who have actually come forward and said, they were in favor of this law, and now they recognize that it is a problem. It needs to be removed. But they remain pastors. Mm-hmm. They have their personal moral beliefs, and they have resolved this conflict. But once Brendan went and gave testimony in the way that he did, it means no, he is in conflict with a fundamental aim of CHART, which is that of reducing stigma. How can you have a person who is supporting the upholding of a law in which the entire HIV fraternity in the Caribbean is saying this law is an obstruction? There is a conflict. And then the constituency itself, not just the vulnerable populations and MSM, other public health experts, donors, are saying, you know, but this is a conflict. Brendan, if he really felt he needed to testify, I think the best thing would be for him then to have resigned from that position and continue his work in a different forum.
Okay. When we come back, we want to discuss this issue of resigning and the science of his testimony. We're speaking with Dr. Peter Figueroa. Peter, please hold the line for us, and we'll be back with you in a few moments.
Okay.
The radio station of the nation. The nation.
And we're back with you. This is the morning edition. My name is Lloyd D'Aguilar. We're speaking to Dr. Peter Figueroa, who I should say was formerly the Chief of Epidemiology and AIDS at the Ministry of Health, and is an honorary professor at the University of the West Indies and honorary research fellow at the UA. Is that correct?
Well, I'm really a full professor at the university. I'm employed as an academic at the university at this point.
Okay, very well. All right, now this issue of resigning, to me, it's a sore matter because, as you know, politicians don't resign in Jamaica. And I thought that the thing to have done for Dr. Bain would have been for Dr. Bain to resign. And, you know, but he hasn't resigned. He hasn't given any public explanation. But don't you think that there would be more clarity if he had just taken a position to resign? And this question of due process, was due process applied? Because I get the impression, based on what the Vice Chancellor said, that there were discussions with him about this. It's not that he just received a letter one morning saying that you're fired.
Yes. The Vice Chancellor, in fact, has weighed this very carefully and consulted widely, both within the university and outside of it. This was not a decision taken lightly. There were several meetings with Brendan, by the Vice Chancellor, and with others also. So this was not a preemptory strike or anything like that whatsoever. The Vice Chancellor weighed this very carefully, and like the rest of us, knowing Brendan well, it was not an easy decision.
So due process was applied then, as you say, it wasn't a peremptory strike.
No.
And what about resigning? Do you think I don't want to use the word honorable thing, but wouldn't it have been easier or better for him to have just tendered his resignation?
Well, what is interesting is, you know, that this was discussed within PANCAP because Brendan was on one of the leading bodies of PANCAP. And the majority of persons within the leadership of PANCAP were clear that his position was untenable, that there was a significant conflict, because here you have a leader of PANCAP who is expressly going against one of the primary objectives of PANCAP. And, you know, we invited Brendan to resign. He resisted. And when he realized that PANCAP was serious, then he withdrew. Now, within the...
When you say he withdrew, what do you mean?
He withdrew from the leadership of PANCAP. He resigned from the leadership of PANCAP.
Okay.
Within the university, initially, when there were discussions with Brendan, I am aware of the Vice Chancellor saying to Brendan, Brendan, at least show some recognition that you intended no harm to the community who are concerned about your testimony. Show some gesture towards them. But Brendan did not feel that they had addressed him directly. They had addressed the Vice Chancellor. So Brendan had the, many of us encouraged him to resign, but he did not feel that way, and therefore it forced the Vice Chancellor's hand.
All right, let's talk about the science now, because one of the things that jumps at me when I was reading the his testimony is the claim that anal sex, and maybe I'm not summarizing exactly what he said, but he seems to be suggesting that anal sex carries a higher risk of HIV transmission than, you know, heterosexual
Absolutely.
Is that correct?
Yes, this is well accepted within the field.
Mm-hmm.
If you think about it, the Ministry of Health, from the time I've been in charge of the program, the HIV response in Jamaica, we have always said that anal sex, persons who participate in anal sex, are at highest risk of HIV.
Mm-hmm.
There is no question about this, and nobody contests that point. However, the way that he presented it did not make clear that anal sex is not only between men and men, but some heterosexual men also have anal sex with women. So there's a way in which the testimony promoted a negative stereotype of men who have sex with men. But there are other important flaws, because the main purpose of his testimony was really with respect to, does the law act as a barrier promoting stigma and discrimination? There's a whole body of experience as well as evidence, scientific evidence, showing that in fact the law is a barrier, and the weight of the evidence is that it is a barrier. Now, you have to be careful how you take associations and consider them to be causal. But within the Caribbean, those countries that have anti-buggery legislation like Jamaica, Guyana, Trinidad and Belize, the prevalence among men who have sex with men is 20% or higher. In those Caribbean countries that do not have these laws, Cuba, Dominican Republic, Suriname, Bahamas, the prevalence of HIV among MSM is under 10%.
And he didn't mention that in his...
No, he did not mention this. And he didn't address the whole human rights aspect of the issue. And, you know, from our own experience of dealing with persons who are vulnerable, they are fearful of doing a test. They are fearful of getting the result. If it is positive, they're afraid of coming in for treatment. They're afraid of disclosing their status to their sexual partners. And why is this? Because whether you're a gay man or a heterosexual, you are concerned that people will view you as a gay and that you are breaking the law. And there's a horrendous stigma associated with HIV and, you know, just following through with testing and treatment.
But Dr. Figueroa, it's very important at this particular stage of the conversation between us that even though we are saying that there's a higher incidence of HIV among men who have sex with men, or even men who have sex with women, I mean, anal sex with women, heterosexual sex also carries the risk of HIV transmission as well.
Absolutely.
And could you address the incidence of that or the circumstances under which HIV is transmitted among heterosexuals?
Well, certainly. Once someone has unprotected sex,
mm-hmm.
then they are at risk of HIV and other sexually transmitted infections. And we have individuals, unfortunately, nearly 20% of the persons who have become infected with HIV in Jamaica, primarily women, report only one sexual partner. So they have become infected through their regular main sexual partner because their main sexual partner has either had past experiences in which he picked up HIV or he has other current sexual partners. So this is why we keep hammering away that you must use a condom when you have sex, or both partners have to get tested, and if both of you are negative and you're not having other sexual partners, then you may not need to use a condom.
But doesn't this apply to both homosexuals and heterosexuals?
It does, but it's much more difficult, for instance, for homosexual terms of they not only need condoms, they need lubricants.
I know, but if both partners are HIV free, there's almost no risk of them passing on HIV to each other. The
that
same thing
correct.
Would apply to heterosexuals, right?
If you have two men
yeah.
who are negative
yes.
and having sex with each other and they do not have any other partner,
yes.
then they will not get infected. So the same rules apply
to both
heterosexuals and homosexuals.
And homosexuals. So why don't we just talk then about protecting ourselves when we have sex, no matter, you know, what your sexual orientation is? Shouldn't that be...
Yes, that is correct. But at the same time, you have to tailor your messages specifically to different audiences. Otherwise, they don't hear them. We have to speak directly to young people in the way that they would appreciate. We have to address the MSM community directly. We have to reach out to sex workers. In this kind of work, you have to go and interact with the different populations specifically and work with them. And you have to have a supportive environment to help them to practice safe sex.
And the point that I'm really trying to get at, Dr. Figueroa, is that there is no need to criminalize MSM then, you know?
No, criminalizing makes it worse.
Yes.
We have come to that clear conclusion. And unfortunately, Brendan's testimony is like a director of child health in the Ministry of Health saying that, you know, maybe vaccines don't work, which would be totally ridiculous based on our experience of vaccines preventing childhood diseases. It just, you know, it's just not a tenable position.
All right, we have to leave it there. Thank you very much, Dr. Peter Figueroa, for enlightening us and on this matter of whether it's freedom of speech, academic freedom, or it's a conflict of interest. And the honorable thing perhaps for Dr. Bain to have done would have been to resign. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lloyd.